Yes, so breach is the most common malpresentation. The normal presentation we all know is cephalic, and breach is a malpresentation. And by breach presentation, we mean that fetus is lying in a longitudinal lie with podalic pole in lower part of the uterus. So longitudinal lie means spine of the baby is corresponding to the long axis of the uterus. And in this position, the baby is lying, and the instead of the head, it is the buttocks which are lying in the lower part of the uterus. It is more common in preterm pregnancies and at term deliveries, that is the babies who are delivering after 37 weeks. We find that 3 to 4 out of 100 women have got this malpresentation. But this malpresentation is much more common at lesser gestational ages. So an easy way to remember can be the incidence is about 30% at 30 weeks and 3% at term. So why is this topic important? Whenever you study any topic in any subject, you should know what is the importance. Why have we included this in your curriculum? The reason being, babies with breech presentation have a worse outcome than cephalic. And we all know obstetric is the only branch where we have got two patients at a time, mother as well as fetus. And fetus is looked after the obstetricians till the time it gets delivered. And when there is a breech presentation, outcome for the baby is not as good as that for a cephalic presentation. It is worse than the cephalic. So it's important, one of our patients is not going to do well if it's a breech. And that's why you all need to know about it. So why this baby doesn't go good when it is breech? The reason being, most worrisome is difficulty in delivery when the head comes out later than the buttocks. As in breech, you can logically see. So this after coming head can get stuck, and baby can die of asphyxia during delivery or have severe hypoxia that can compromise its neurological intactness. Secondly, the breech does not fit the passage as well as the head, and there are small gaps left on its side, and cord can get pushed out as the patient is laboring. And once the cord comes out, this is called as cord prolapse. This can be cause acute fetal hypoxia. The baby's oxygen supply can be acutely cut off, and baby can again be hypoxic or baby can die. Then it is seen that the babies who already are malformed, they are more likely to present as breech. So when a breech baby delivers, it is more likely to have malformation than say a cephalic delivering, and then the baby will not do good. Then the manipulations done to deliver the baby may also cause injuries to baby. All right, and there can be premature respiratory efforts and aspiration. Can you hear me so far well? So far, can you hear me? All right. I get to see that you can hear me. So this is the reason why we need to know about this. Now, causes of fetal death in breech, as we have just discussed, asphyxia, hypoxia, cord prolapse, or cord can get compressed as it comes out by the side of the fetal presenting part. Then there can be delay in delivery of head. This is the most crucial and worrisome thing. It is very traumatic for the obstetrician to see that baby is, how most of it has come out, the head is inside and head is not coming out, and the baby dies right in front of your eyes within minutes. It is, I tell you, very traumatic even to the doctors who is dealing with such delivery. Then when there is a breech delivery, there is no time for head to mold. When there is a cephalic delivery, head is gradually coming down into the pelvis and it gets, there is some molding, so that sudden changes in pressure on the head don't occur. But in breech, there can be either because of lack of molding or because of manipulations or these things, the intracranial hemorrhage can occur. And then there can be intra-abdominal organ injuries to the baby. As we hold the baby, as I will show you in my later slides, when we are holding the baby, we are holding it gently with our hands, but at times if you inadvertently apply more pressure, they can be injury to the baby's intra-abdominal organs. Then prematurity, we just talked about 30% of incidence is there in 30 weeks. So prematurity per se can harm the baby, and fetal malformation due to which the breach occurs can also per se harm the baby. Now it is important to know, what do we expect out of you when we say there is going to be a case on breach? Suppose you get a long case with some patient with breach presentation admitted, or you on an obstetric viva table, we are given a breach and we can ask you certain questions. So what are these questions? So these are the questions that I'm already disclosing, which will be asked in the exam. These are how to identify a breach presentation in an antenatal patient. Then to decide which breech babies can be delivered with reasonable safety. And once we have decided that this can be delivered, then how to actually conduct the delivery. And also the most important part that we always remember is counsel the parents. The parents, the family of the woman and her husband have to be told that despite best of our efforts, there is a small possibility of fetal harm during delivery. Now, any patients will ask, what is this small? I mean, what do you mean by how small is it? Is it 1 in 2, 1 in 10? So roughly 1 in 20, 1 in 30, you can say, babies, deliveries that we take, one baby may get some harm. So what are the factors that predispose to breach? The prematurity is most common, always remember. Then you can mentally classify them as the causes in the uterus, in the fetus, or placenta and lica. So if there is uterine malformation, these are the things that I have listed, septate, biconvoid, didelphys, then there can be, so the baby, the position can be such that it can become breech. If there are large fibroids or myomas, as we call them, in the lower part of the uterus, that will prevent head from coming down, again it will be breech. Then fetal factor twin pregnancy. When we talk of twin pregnancy, we are most worried about the presentation of the first twin. Okay. And then there is fetal malformation, hydrocephalus, very large head, anencephalus, when the head is just not formed, only base of skull is there. A fetal sacrococcygeal teratoma, large tumor in the buttocks part. So the baby that occupies the lower part of the uterus. Fetal thyroid goiter, when the head gets extended and it cannot come down. Then placenta and lica, placenta previa, when the placenta is filling the lower uterine sedges cavity and there is less space for head to sit there. Excessive lica as well as less lica can predispose to breech. Excessive lica because there is plenty of space and the baby likes to move, and so it may not remain stay in the cephalic and rather may turn whenever it feels like. And oligamnios means because you have seen that baby is breech in premature babies and it turns cephalic when the term approaches. So if there is less lica, this less lica may prevent fetal movement and baby may stay as breech. So both excessive and less lica can predispose to breech presentation. So far, have you understood whatever I'm trying to say? Then I'll proceed further. part is buttocks and the external genitalia. These rounded buttocks, they are similar almost to the cephalic. They exert uniform pressure all around like cephalic presentation. And this is conducive for vaginal delivery. Whereas you see this, here along with the buttock, the feet is also sitting here. This is more commonly seen in multipara. So the presenting parts are buttocks, external genitalia and feet. So the pressure, because of these feet, the pressure on cervix is not uniform all around. And there are chances that some cord or this cord can, a small loop can come by side and cause cord prolapse. This is conducive for vaginal delivery still, but incidence of cord prolapse becomes a little higher. So we have to be more conscious in these babies. Then there is footling breach, when one or both feet present in lower segment. Now when this is like this, you see this, the whole bag of membrane and lichen is occupied by this. Whereas here, it is lying loose and this is a little above and feet is here. So the incidence of early rupture of membranes can occur and there is much more chance that this cord will slip out. There is plenty of space around his feet for cord to slip out. And this is not suitable for vaginal delivery. Theoretically, one more presentation is described where it's knee presentation. When this is the head gets, the baby is presenting by knee, but that is something which I don't think I have ever seen and I will not talk about it. So for you, it is either a frank or extended breach, flexed or a complete breach and footling breach. You remember these three things. The risk of cord prolapse, as I have just explained, is lowest with the frank breach. Mediocre with 4 to 6% with complete breach. And with footling breach, 15 to 18%. So it remains very high risk. Even prior to actual delivery happening, during labor also, these babies are at risk. And whenever we do a PV, in a case where there is a breach presentation, particularly a complete breach, we are very mindful that we are looking for any loop of cord that might be descending. And if that is so, we immediately take the baby up for cesarean. In footling breach, we do not allow vaginal delivery. We take up for cesarean. In frank, the risk is very low and we can permit vaginal breach delivery with reasonable safety. So how do we diagnose breach on clinical examination? So for you, it is abdominal palpation. PGs, of course, we teach that how to examine on vaginal examination also. So if you find the soft irregular breach of occupying lower pole of uterus on pelvic grips, and we find the head which is bellotable. Bellotable means when you move it from side to side, it moves and it comes back to its previous position, is in the fundus on fundal grip. And if a vaginal examination is done, then instead of the hard head, you feel soft parts of the fetus, buttock, external genitalia, anal opening is felt. And at times, of course, if the breach is not low enough, then on PV, you may not be able to differentiate. And it's only after membrane rupture that one can really feel fetal parts very well. But if the breach is a little descended, that even through membranes, you can easily make out. Anything which is not hard is breach. But at times in a frank breach, the sacrum and all, it feels hard. So one may confuse with cephalic presentation. So always reassess, corroborate with your abdominal findings, and then make a diagnosis. Then role of ultrasound. Of course, when in an antenatal patient who is not laboring, we are in doubt, we confirm our finding by ultrasound examination, where we can clearly see whether the breach is, baby is lying as cephalic or breach. And but this usually can't be done in the laboring patient. In laboring patient, you do a PV finding to confirm, or in case you have a portable ultrasound which can be brought to the patient bedside, then you can do. Whenever we do ultrasound for a woman who is at term breach, term pregnancy with breach, we can confirm the diagnosis. Whatever clinical findings are there, they can be confirmed. We can confirm that the baby's maturity is correct, it's a mature baby, how many weeks of parameters, fetal parameters are there. We can estimate fetal weight. It helps us decide whether we can permit vaginal delivery or not. If baby is too big or too small, we do not like to permit vaginal delivery. One can detect fetal and uterine anomalies, localize the placenta, any fibroid, or at times even pelvic tumors. They may cause, but usually it's the fibroid. So ovarian tumor will rise up and will not usually interfere with the presentation. Then comes the management. So what do you do in antenatal management? In antenatal, everything is all right. There is no problem. When the, just the way the baby is in cephalic presentation, baby is in breech. So as such, in antenatal, till term, we are hardly worried about anything extra to be done because of breech presentation. Only thing is, we like to look for causes which can affect our decision making and affect our fetal prognosis. So we should identify the fetal malformations and particularly placenta previa, because if it's placenta previa, then we are doing an elective cesarean and we are not going to allow the patient to go in labor. If there are fetal malformations, suppose it's a legal malformation, I know this baby will not survive, then I will not give a cesarean delivery. I will say, oh, let's go ahead with vaginal delivery, even if vaginal delivery can cause further harm, because this baby is anyway not going to survive. So why give a scar to the woman? Then there is something called as external cephalic version. This is very important. Whenever we talk of breech, we expect you to say something about external cephalic version. So this is a manipulative procedure to change the lie or bring a favorable pole to the lower part of the uterus. It is done at 36 to 38 weeks. After making out, ruling out any contraindication, OPD procedures done under ultrasound guidance and continuous fetal heart monitoring without any anesthesia. And we keep things ready so that if there is any case of fetal heart abnormality, we can immediately do cesarean. So this is done per abdominally. We hold the baby by head and by buttocks per abdominally, and we try to flex the head and push the pole in the opposite direction. And then we just, this is how we try to gently turn the baby around. We ask the patient to be fasting in that place. When we do it, fasting, because if while turning around there is some problem and I have to rush for cesarean, then there is no problem. At times we give some mild uterine relaxant like nifedipine so that the uterus doesn't contract and we can do our procedure well. And we simultaneously we are checking on fetal heart. If we find there is problem with the fetal heart while we have done the procedure, we either revert it or immediately rush the baby to the cesarean. So external cephalic version is something that I would like all of you to know. And whenever you are posted with us in obstetrics department, you can ask somebody at least theoretically to show you on the baby how we go about doing it. Then you should know what all factors to consider. Age, parity, age very precious. I mean, in an elderly lady, it may not be, if it is a lax uterus, you can do it. If it is a very, you know, like a nulliparous primary gravida, uterus is very tight, hugging the baby, it may not be so easy. Type of breech, if it is extended breech, then this is the best type of breech that we can turn around. Associated complicating factors like hypertension are there, we do not like to do it. Baby size, too big or too small, we do not like to do it. Size and shape of pelvis, if pelvis, we can turn, we are, the purpose of doing external cephalic version is that baby should become cephalic presentation and deliver. So if the pelvis is inadequate and it cannot deliver even as cephalic, so why do external cephalic version? Then history of previous difficult deliver, labor. Again, we know this baby is not going to, this woman may have problem in the vaginal delivery. So why turn to cephalic? So only in women where we feel that vaginal delivery is very much feasible, there we attempt doing this external cephalic version for brief presentation at about beyond 36 weeks. Contraindications are previous cesarean, twins, medical obstetric complication, as I just said, hypertension, uterine or fetal anomalies. Again, we don't. What are the factors favoring elective cesarean delivery? I mean, what are the factors where you will avoid doing external cephalic version, avoid doing vaginal delivery, elderly patient, nulliparous, type of breech? If already we know extended breech, it's good. If it is non-extended, you suspect it is a hyper, any, it's a baby size is very big, more than 3.5 or very small. If the head is hyper-extended, once the head gets hyper-extended, then it's difficult to conduct a vaginal breech delivery and we like to do cesarean, and this can be identified clinically and if not, definitely on ultrasound. Bad obstetric history, she has previous pregnancy losses, and this pregnancy, we do not want to take any risk sort of inexperienced obstetrician. If the obstetrician is not experienced enough to conduct a vaginal breech delivery, then we have to do elective cesarean. So all these are indications for doing elective cesarean delivery in a breech presentation. Have you understood it so far? Yes, so far I am clear. Okay, so somebody, I can see Nilayan Sarkar responding to me that it's clear. If there are any query, you can always post it. I will try to answer them. So now we move on to the next section of this talk. This chapter, then the indication of cesarean in labor. At times we have decided that we are going to conduct a vaginal breech delivery, but we may have to do a cesarean during labor also. And what are these reasons? In first stage fetal distress, which can happen even in cephalic, if there is a cord prolapse or cord presentation that we detect, or in second stage failure of descent. Suppose the breech is, the buttocks are just not descending, or if there is a fetal distress, then we have to resort to cesarean even during labor. Then the very, very difficult question, how to conduct a breech delivery, which all of us are scared. Even the consultants feel scared and they are apprehensive if at all they have to do a breech delivery, because it is a requires much expertise. One should be very clear about what is to be done and what is not to be done. And this is more of a PG topic, but for the sake of having some idea, I need to teach it to you. So I'll be doing it briefly. This topic is best studied when you have face-to-face interaction in small batches with us, when you are posted with us. I know some batches are posted with us. Those posted in my unit can come to the OT today and we can all try to show you. Or in the OPD or wherever when you are posted with us. So these, when we talk of delivery, we talk of position. Position means how the fetus is placed inside the uterus with respect to the various parts of maternal pelvis. So that, though in this figure you can see, I'm trying to show you all possible positions, but four main positions are there. These are left sector. Suppose here is the maternal abdomen. Suppose this abdomen is lying like that. Suppose the woman is lying. Then left sacroanterior is this. If patient is lying, patient's left is this side and sacrum is towards this side. Left sacroanterior. This is the right sacroanterior. The baby is lying obliquely. So here the sacrum is pointing towards left iliopubic eminence. Try to visualize what I am saying. Left sacroanterior means sacrum is towards maternal left iliopubic eminence. Right sacroanterior, sacrum is towards the right sacroanus, right iliopubic eminence. And we say left sacroposterior, where the fetus is lying towards the left sacroiliac joint, the sacrum of the fetus. Here the sacrum of the fetus is lying towards the right sacroiliac joint. So you really need to try to visualize it, and this will be better understood when you have a dummy pelvis and the fetus in your hand. Now, what are the types of vaginal delivery? Assisted vaginal delivery is the most preferred method. By spontaneous vaginal delivery, we mean we have not touched and the baby has simply come out on its own. So this is not to be encouraged. We don't want it to happen, but it does happen usually in preterm breechery, and that too outside the hospital setup. In hospital, we will be very careful and mindful and standing with the patient and assisting the breech as it is delivering out. Spontaneous means we have not done anything, the baby has just come out. In assisted, this is what we are going to do, I'll just cover. Breech extraction is done under anesthesia in certain situations, where all part extracting the baby, the whole baby is extracted by the obstetrician only, and without much, you know, inputs by the mother. Mother is under anesthesia, she cannot push. That induction of labor is controversial, and by and large, we do not induce labor in a patient with breech delivery, breech presentation. So mechanism of labor, principal movements occur at three levels, and assistance is needed at these three levels. What are these? The buttocks, the shoulders or the arms as we say them, and the head. Remember, these are the most, if I tell you what all you should remember, I will say these four. Even if you forget everything else, just remember these four. The delivery should be completed in 3 to 4 minutes. Now it may sound very less, but actually when you are doing it and doing it correctly, 3 and 4 minutes is a sufficient time. Assess the baby as distance. Do not pull forcibly. The moment you pull forcibly, the arms will get extended, head can get extended, and then the baby cannot come out. Hold the baby with breech towel. What is breech towel? It's not nothing special. Just any piece of cloth is a breech towel. Once legs are delivered, because baby is slippery with lycra and mucosa and vernix. And if you try to hold it with gloved hands, baby will slip out of your head and injure. So hold with the breech towel so that the baby doesn't slip down. And keep the back interior. This is the mantra. Keep the back interior, keep the back interior. So these are the most important points to be remembered in the breech delivery. Again, I will ask, are you all with me? Do you have any queries so far? Yes, please. Anybody can respond? Have you understood? Yes. Nilayan, I feel you are the only one sitting in the class, Dipinder too. So these points which I have written in blue are very important. Do mention them if you are asked for in the exam. Examiner will know that you have understood this. So this requires high degree of obstetric skill, should be conducted by an experienced obstetrician or by somebody under supervision of an experienced obstetrician for our postgraduates. Keep anesthetists and neonatologists on standby. They should be standing right over there, ideally speaking. Some people, careful pelvic assessment in early labor. You have seen that the pelvis is adequate. But in early labor, again assess, is the pelvis adequate for this baby? If it is not, please do a cesarean. Any other complicating factor that it may come to light at this time, again assess. Whenever there is ruptured membranes, whenever a patient laboring in breech is there, we tell her not to move around. We tell her to stay in bed. Remember, this is different. Whenever there is a cephalic presentation, we encourage women to walk around. In breech, we say women should stay in bed. And whenever she says there is some water coming down, she has broken her water, as she says, or there is leaking, spontaneous rupture of membrane, do a PV to exclude cord collapse. Adequate analgesia is given in first stage, as is for all. Always confirm. The most important point is tell the patient not to push down. Patient will get urged to push out. Tell her not to push down till you have confirmed that cervix is fully derated. Because if you start conducting, patient starts pushing down, or you start conducting the delivery, encourage her to push down when cervix is not completely derated, there is head will not come out. For buttocks are compressible, they are all soft tissue. So they may slip out even with slightly less dilated cervix, say about 8 to 9 centimeters. But the head diameter is 9.4 centimeters. It will just not come out if you start conducting delivery in less than fully dilated cervix. Head will get trapped and the baby will die. So always confirm this. What are the maneuvers that we do? We do maneuvers at the three levels that I told you, buttocks and legs, then arms or the shoulders, and then comes the head. So for the buttocks, we have to give episiotomy. When we start patient, buttocks start distending the perineum, we give a general episiotomy. And gentle groin, I will show you by pictures. So this is a picture of groin traction. You see buttocks are delivering out. You can see the buttocks are here, just there. And then at that time, when she is getting good contraction, so when the patient is giving good contraction, place one finger here. You can either place one finger, or you can have one finger here and one finger on the other side, and you gently pull. And the pulp of the finger is towards, not towards the femur, but towards the other side. If you pull it, keeping pressure here on the femur, there can be fracture of femur. So it has to be done very gently with guarded force and with the feet, with the maternal efforts and uterine contraction. So this is the gentle groin traction. Next is the Pinard maneuver. So what happens at times, the buttocks have come out till here, but I can't feel the feet here, or it is a little away. So this is a Pinard maneuver. We gently take the head a little inside till the popliteal fascia. We abduct it. We bring it out, the head gently, not much, just slightly. The head then, this feet then falls down. I can get, grasp his feet and bring out feet. After this, the other, this most face, the other feet also comes down and both feet can be brought down. This is what is shown in this also. Press on the popliteal fossa slightly abduct, and when the head, this comes down, hold it and gently pull it out. So this is what the Pinard maneuver is. No, sorry, I've gone on the. So next comes after, what do we do after Pinard maneuver? Keep the back interior. This is the mantra. Here they are seeing that they are holding the baby just like that, but hold the baby with the beach towel. Because as you are holding it, your hand will get slippery. Keep the back interior, keep the back interior. Mantra for the vaginal beach. Do not pull, do not pull. Gentle traction. This is the most important thing. Then delivering the arms. You see, as the baby delivers till here, and till the umbilicus, we gently mobilize a loop of cord so that this doesn't get stretched. And as the baby is slipping out, you will feel that scapula here. You can feel the scapula here. And then you, as you palpate, you can feel the arms here. And you gently just put the finger. You can see how the doctor has put the finger in front and gently holding it. You can see gently, just pull it out by the side of the baby. Once you have done on this side, go to the opposite side. That other arm will come out more easily because there is more space. So the important thing is to check that the arms are here. And mostly the arms are here and they just are pulled out one by one as shown in this figure. So first we had assisted the groin, delivery by groin traction. Then if legs don't come out, legs will come out if it's a flexed, as you bring out the groin flexed, breech mein aa jayenge. But if it is an extended head, extended leg, sorry, as in frank breech, you may need to do a Pinard, but not always. Mostly we don't have to do a Pinard. Legs come out easily. After that, you mobilize the cord to one side so that it is not overstretched. Then once the scapula are felt here, you gently go for and feel for the arms. Arms will be here and you bring them out one by one. So now the arms are delivered. Now what next? The problem occurs when the arms are not felt as they were felt here. You do not feel the arms here. Arms are lying by the side of the head or above and your fingers cannot reach that high. So what, how to deliver those arms? For that, there is something called as Lofset element, a maneuver. It is used to deliver the extended arms. The fetus is grasped as shown here. You see, you are holding by side from the hip. You are not holding the thighs. You are not holding the abdomen. You are holding this by the side of the fetus pelvis. And your thumbs are kept parallel to the fetal spine. And you keep the baby stretched. Keep the baby stretched and you turn the back. You know the way of the back is through 180 degree until posterior arms comes anterior. The principle behind it is that when we talk of pelvic inlet, there is sacral promontory, there is pubic symphysis. The sacral promontory is at a little higher level. Pubic symphysis is at a little lower level. And when you're keeping stretch, when you rotate the baby, the posterior arm, which was above the sacrum, will come below the pubic symphysis as you are rotating by 180 degree while keeping the baby taut. I will repeat again. You hold a baby like this, grasping around fetus pelvis. Your thumbs are on the side of the spine. You keep the baby straight. Turn the baby around by 180 degree so that the posterior arms comes interior. And when this comes anterior, because of the pubic symphysis being at a lower level, you gently depress it. When it comes anterior, gently depress it. The shoulder will come below the pubic symphysis and then you can easily reach for arm and deliver one after the other. Is it clear? I want to know, because this Lofset is actually a little tricky. It's difficult for me to explain just by picture and by my words. And these are best explained. How do we decide which arm is posterior? Well, you know the baby is lying outside, so you can make out baby is usually, when you see the baby hanging out. All right, this is Purva. Purva, I'll just answer your question. I will just answer your question. Let's see. Like you're using this baby. So this arm is a little posterior. The other arm is more anterior. So when you rotate, keeping the back anterior, and then you, when this arm becomes anterior, gently press. This will come. You have to visualize, like this thing, like this, like, you know, when this baby will come out, baby comes out like this, mostly anterior, mostly in a little oblique position. So this arm will be posterior, this arm here above will be anterior. This is how you decide which arm is posterior and which arm is anterior. I would like Purva to confirm, has she understood this? Lof said, ma'am, so back becomes anterior. Back will become a little oblique. Nilayan, back will become a little oblique as the, you see, a posterior. Purva, have you understood? You are most welcome to come to my OPD or any time and I can show you. Or whenever you are posted with whichever unit, you can get this doubts clarified. And further, I will tell you, try to understand it once, but don't become too paranoid about knowing it very perfectly, because you will not be conducting it. For you, the more important thing is to be able to identify breach. To be able to identify breach, to know antenatally what is to be done, and understand what is to be counseled. This, as I told you, are conducted by expert obstetrician, and you are basic doctors. I don't expect you to deliver a breach, but I expect you to do something theoretical. That's why I'm telling you. So this is, I've done this, then the delivery of egg. Most important, it some other person gives up suprapubic pressure, it maintains flexion of head, so the lesser diameters of head are coming down the pelvis. So these are the three techniques, and I will show them by photograph. This is the burn marshal. This is the burn marshal. Allow the baby to hang by its weight. When the nape of the neck, now when I was a student like you, I could never understand nape of the head. But when I became a little older, like a PG, I understood by nape of head, this is an English term, they mean baby's fetal hairline. Okay, when the hairline is visible, hold feet of the baby like this. And keep the body stretched. You see the baby's body is stretched. Swing the feet in long arch towards abdomen of the mother like this. So holding the baby, you bring it above, but you have to keep this axis very straight. Simultaneously, suprapubic pressure is given by the assistant, and with the left hand, you can guard the perineum. So there is no excessive damage. Of course, you have been given the episiotomy at the time of groin delivery itself, if you would remember, before groin traction. So just remember one thing, timing is most important. If you try to come attempt this technique before the hairline is visible, extension will occur at the level of cervical spine. The baby will die. There will be fracture of the cervical spine. So the timing and knowing when to do it is most important in this technique. Have you understood this? Again, I'll be interacting with you and asking you, have you understood this, Burn Marshall? Nilayan, yes. Ekta has responded. Nilayan, I will explain to you. When we say back anterior, it doesn't mean exactly anterior. It means largely anterior. It may be a little oblique, but still it looks like anterior only. Because why will the posterior, if the back is perfectly anterior, then the shoulder will be on right and left. So when we say anterior, but by that we mean it is slightly in oblique, but largely anterior, so that one shoulder is a little posterior. Nilayan, is that clear? Okay, thank you, Nilay. But I'm sure it's very difficult to understand. You can come and do it when you're posted. So coming on to the next slide, that is Morisot's Smelly Weight Technique. Now you see how the baby is being held. Because what is the worry in burn marshal? That if we do wrong timing, there can be injury to the cervical spine. So here, my left or the doctor's left and right hand are splinting the cervical spine. They are keeping the, they will holding the baby in such a manner that there is no movement allowed at the cervical spine. And with left hand, we keep left hand under the baby, under the belly of the baby, under the baby's abdomen. And my two fingers are will be on the malar eminency, the index and the ring. Middle finger is either at the fetal chin or in the baby's mouth. And the right hand is kept on the two shoulders. All right, that is the index and the ring finger. And the middle finger goes towards the occiput. So again, I repeat, baby is lying over your left hand. Index finger and the ring finger are on malar eminences on the cheeks of the baby. And the middle finger is on the fetal mouth or fetal chin. The right hand, index and ring fingers are on the fetal shoulder. And middle finger is on the occiput. Assistance is again giving the subclavicular pressure. And this is the direction. So this finger is pushing it here. This finger is, you know, pushing it, pulling it down. And the cervical spine is splinted. And this is the way we try to bring the patient, the baby out. This is the how to decide which maneuver to be used to deliver. This is Dharia. Dharia is a very good question. I'm glad you are with me. Actually, there is more, it's more of an individual preference, I would say. If you ask me, even as a PG, I never liked to do burn marshal. I was worried that I will harm the baby's cervical spine as an individual. But I have seen many, many patients, more people do burn marshal than they do moisture spin. So I can say there is nothing to decide. It's a matter of individual preference and individual practice, how you do it. But whichever maneuver you do it, become proficient in that and do it properly, as has been described. So is that very clear, Dharia? Okay, dear. Now I move on to the other menu, other way to do it, and that is by forceps. And how do we do by forceps? This is how. This is just a picture, you know. You put a cloth underneath the baby like this. Assistant is holding the baby up. And from underneath the baby, you apply the forceps, left blade first, followed by the right forceps, right blade. And once you have grasped the fetal head and locked the blades, then you gently pull out along with the uterine contraction and maternal effort while suprapubic pressure is being given. The important thing for you to know is use a long forceps, not an outlet forceps, because that thread is higher than in the, it's not in the outlet, it's a little higher. Pipus is a special forceps which has been designed to deliver out after coming head, which has got slight curve behind. As you can see here, this is a pipus forceps. It is not shaped straight as it, you will find in long forceps, all in the same axis. This is not. And this is, in fact, it may seem complicated, but it is probably the safest way to deliver the after coming head, because head is totally grasped, caged in this forceps, and it cannot move in any abnormal direction and cause harm. So breech extraction. Just know the word breech extraction, that it is done in the under general anesthesia. That is all I want to know. It cannot be done in the labor room. Baby is taken to the OT under full, and this is done only when the there is second stage, when there is full dilatation. Only done at full size. So these are the two things most important: general anesthesia, full dilatation, and we do under anesthesia. We do whatever steps that we have explained to you, we will do it one after the other, and we extract the baby out. And frankly speaking, it's very, very rare. In several years do we get to do one breech extraction, hardly ever we do it. So for you, it is assisted breech delivery, as I have told you. Spontaneous breech delivery, not to be encouraged. Breech extraction is a rarity. It is only assisted breech delivery or a cesarean for you. And if possible, do a version, external cephalic version antenatally, to avoid breech delivery altogether. So is that clear so far? Yes, my children. Is it clear so far? Okay, I get Ekta. Thank you, Ekta. Thank you, Mrityunjay. So I'm glad that you have understood it. Now I move on to after that. So after baby is delivered, thank God, and we have completed the task in 3 to 4 minutes. You will understand that taking more time means the baby will not survive. There will be hypoxia, baby will die, and it is very traumatic. Suppose one is conducting a breech delivery. You are holding that baby, that live, new life, and because of delay in delivery, the baby is dying in your hands. Can you imagine how scarred an obstetrician can be? It is a very risky business. We are as obstetrician in risky business. So we train ourselves very well and we do only what is safe. If I am not confident that this delivery will happen without complication, I will not rather attempt it and do a safe cesarean. Once the baby is delivered, we hand it over to the baby's doctor, that is the neonatologist. We deliver the placenta as per cephalic delivery. We check for any vaginal tears, any extension of episiotomy. In case that there's PPH, then of course atonic PPH is most common, but do rule out cervical tears, because there is definitely more maneuvering, more manipulation in breech delivery than in the cephalic delivery. Now I would like to say one thing. This is the last slide, but I would like to talk about you about something to give you a background about breech delivery. See, in the past, cesareans were more complicated, associated with anesthesia problems, sepsis, and all that. So it used to be said that in all cases, breech delivery is to be encouraged to be conducted vaginally, and do not do cesarean just for the sake of breech presentation. But then a few years back, there came a trial, term breech trial. This was a landmark trial, term breech trial. And in this, it was shown that when there is a vaginal breech delivery, vis-a-vis when there is a cesarean delivery for the breech presentation, the fetal harms are much more in vaginal breech delivery than in cesarean. But the maternal harms are almost equal in both. So if the maternal harm is not really much, difference is not there in conducting vaginal breech or doing a cesarean, then why not give benefit of cesarean for the sake of baby? So this was the plea of the trial. After this watershed trial, the practice around the globe has moved more towards cesarean. When we were training, we used to conduct breech deliveries, right, left, center. We used to do cesareans for any indication, but not exclusively for breech presentation. But now, in private sectors, nobody does any breech delivery. No one, mark you. Unless the baby is like, you know, she has just landed in second stage and she's delivering already. In government sectors, we are ours is a teaching institution, and we want everybody to be trained in breech delivery, because all women with breech presentation do not require cesarean section. We should rather be aware about correct selection of patients where we can do breech delivery safely and where we should do elective cesareans. Or for that matter, even if the patient has come late during labor, intrapartum, during labor also, we can do a cesarean section. So proper evaluation is very important. And this is what, how can we can reduce, because you would have realized by this end of this lecture, mother is not at harm because of breech delivery. It is the baby who is at entire harm. And I told you, as obstetrician, we have got two patients, mother and fetus. And fetus is as important to us as the mother. So we have to know that our baby is not at harm. And these are the steps that I have listed that can reduce harm to the baby when baby is presenting by breech. This is use of external cephalic version wherever possible, so that baby becomes cephalic, we don't have to conduct a breech delivery. Careful pelvic assessment so that we can rule out any contracted pelvis or any less safe pelvis. We have that tricky part is this is all subjective. I cannot see, I cannot measure by inch tape, I cannot measure by any imaging. It is my experience as an obstetrician in assessing how roomy the pelvis is. If I find that the pelvic is adequate, it is roomy, then only I will allow a vaginal breech delivery. Identification of complicating factors early. Suppose she has got other factors also, which are alongside with this, I will not conduct a breech delivery. It should be conducted in a well-equipped hospital. You can't just do it in a primary health center. Most important is full dilatation of cervix and skilled obstetrician. Most important. Please do not attempt, if you are not confident. So this is for any postgraduate, though they are not here, only one of my nice postgraduates is here to assist me. And full dilatation of cervix, most important. Neonatologist should always beforehand, you have a senior neonatologist standing by your side to resuscitate. and arrest of if the patient is in labor, you feel the labor is not progressing well during first stage. If you have any doubt about pelvis, even during labor or size, then cesarean is the safest mode of delivery. With this, I conclude my lecture. Any queries, I will be more than happy to answer those. Yes, my dear students. If you want me to repeat, please respond. My lecture is over. Are you there? Can you please repeat Pinard maneuver? This is Nikita. Nikita, I will remove. I will just repeat. We'll just go back. We will go back here. This. We have delivered drawing traction is easy. Simply put a finger here, nicely, snugly, and keeping your palm towards the fetus femur, just pull. This is the Pinard. You see, the buttocks have delivered. So what happens, as you see, these buttocks are like this. You know, they may come out slightly more. For a while because of network problem, but I think I have. Nikita, could you hear my thing or do I repeat it? Because I believe my connection got a little lost. Do I repeat it, Nikita? I will repeat, beta. So you see, Nikita, I will just repeat it for you, beta. So this is how, you see, this was how the groin traction was given. So what happens, once we have pulled it more out, the feet remain here near the neck. And my hand cannot go inside so much to bring the feet. So I have to somehow deliver this feet out. So this is what I do. My hand cannot go till here, but my fingers can reach the popliteal fossa. So I just reach here at the popliteal fossa. I press, I abduct the thigh, and by this maneuver, the feet comes down, and I hold the fetal leg by this and bring it down. One leg is delivered, then there is more space. I can bring the next one also down. And this is how the Pinard maneuver is achieved. Yes, Nikita, is it clear now? Any other query? Otherwise, it's 9:05. I will close my lecture. So please, what I would request you is don't focus on these maneuvers of delivery. I will probably not even ask you any of these. I will ask you all that I told you beforehand. And the last slide. how to prevent mortality in breach. You should know how to examine and identify breach. You should know that I have to rule out placenta previa malformations. You have to know that I have to do explain to the patient there is harm to the baby when vaginal breach occurs, how to counsel, and how to select patient for vaginal delivery or do elective cesarean. This is all that I want. These maneuvers, they look very fancy, very attractive, and I'm sure you would have liked these pictures. They are quite explanatory. So your feedback is very much welcome in any sort. I hope you guys are there with me. Thank you, Ekta, for your attention, all of you. Yes, you don't need to know much in gynae, but whatever you need to know is something very, which is very commonsensical. So when you are studying, study in an intelligent manner, not reading everything. You should know first what is expected out of you in examination and focus on that. As I told you, breach delivery is by expert person. I will ask my PG this. I won't ask you this to do this. Or at least even if I ask you, because you know what happens. Suppose an MBBS doctor is posted at the primary health center and a second breach presentation, woman, multiparous lady in breach presentation comes in labor. There is no time to send. Then an MBBS doctor should know some basic about the delivery. Otherwise, there will be more harm. So this is the reason that I need to anyway talk about this maneuvers. Otherwise, probably I won't even talk about it. So this is why some examiners, they do like to ask, they will give you a pelvis and fetus, keep in breach, and say, how will you manage this breach delivery? So just remember three levels, three maneuvers, and you are done. I will close the lecture now. Thank you. And the people who are posted in my unit can come to the gynae OT. We will be doing a hysterectomy now. How do I stop it?